Hello, this is Dr. Brown. In this video, we're going to go over a review of the kinds of problems you'll be seeing on the final exam. The exam will be pretty comprehensive and cover essentially all the techniques we talked about in this Calculus 1 course. First problem is fundamental, and it's going to find the average rate of change of a function over a given interval. The average rate of change would be equal, in this case, the function is g, would be g of b minus g of a over b minus a. So we need to calculate g at pi over 4 equals 2 plus tangent of pi over 4. Tangent of pi over 4 is 1, so the result is 3. G at minus pi over 4 will be 2 plus tangent. By the way, this is a plus there. 2 plus tangent of pi over 4, or minus pi over 4. This will be minus 1, so the answer is 1. So the average rate of change will be 3. Minus 1 over pi over 4 minus pi over 4 equals 2 over pi over 2, which is equal to 4 over pi. And that is answer B. Second problem is to find the derivative of this interval. And this comes from what I call the second fundamental theorem of calculus, which says that if y equals the integral from a to x of f of t dt, that dy dx equals f of x. In other words, you just put x everywhere you see a t. However, if y is equal to the integral from a to function g of x of f of t dt, dy dx is equal to f of g of x times g prime of x. In other words, you got the chain rule here. You have to multiply the derivative of the upper bound here. So dy dx is equal to ddx of the integral from 0 to x to the 8th cosine of the square root of t dt. So this is equal to cosine of the square root of x to the 8th times ddx of x to the 8th, which is 8x to the 7th cosine of x to the 4th. And that is answer B. Here we have a very simple chain rule problem. We want to take the derivative of this function. And notice that the argument here is not just x. So we have to apply the chain rule. And one of the things about the chain rule is you're not finished taking the derivative until you have looked at the derivative of every function. So we have a function tangent whose derivative is secant squared, but we also have a function pi minus 8 over x. So dy dx will be secant squared of pi minus 8 over x times d dx of pi minus 8x to the minus 1. Notice I've rewritten pi minus 8 over x with the exponent in the numerator. So this is going to be secant squared of pi minus 8 over x times the derivative of pi minus 8 x to the minus 1, which is 0 plus 8 x to the minus 2. Rewriting this, we get 8 over x squared times secant squared of pi minus 8 over x, which is answer C. Problem 4 is an optimization problem. Actually, it's one in which the cost of producing a product that they're developing here, X units, and it says that the unit cost and the unit revenues from the production and sale of X units are related by the cost equals R squared over 252,000 plus 6579, and it wants us to find the rate of change of the unit revenue when the unit cost is changing by 14 units, $14 per unit, and the unit revenue is 1,000. So we are given that DC DX is equal to 14. And we want to find the rate of change of unit revenue, which is DR DX. And C is R squared over 252,000 plus 6579. So DC DX, notice we don't see the variable X here, but we take the derivative with respect to R, which is 2R divided by 252,000 times dr dx, which is the chain rule. So plugging in what we know, dc dx is 14, is equal to 2r, which is 2r is 1,000, divided by 252,000, times dr dx. So you can see that dr dx will be, cross multiplying here, 14 times 252,000 divided by 2 times 1,000 equals 1,764. Unit, and that is answer A. Number five is to use implicit differentiation to figure out what dy dx is for when you have this implicit relationship given here. So what we want to do is take ddx of both sides of the equation. So we take ddx of x times y plus ddx of x plus ddx of y equal ddx of x squared y squared. Now here we need to take into account all of the differentiation rules that we know. Here we have a product, so it's going to be the first, which is x, times the derivative of the second, which is dy dx, plus the second, which is y, times ddx of x. And of course that'll be just one. Then we have ddx of x, which is one, plus dy dx and on the right hand side we have ddx of x squared y squared, which is again a product, which is x squared times ddx of y squared is going to be 2y dy dx using the chain rule. You take the derivative with respect to y, and because you're taking the derivative with respect to x, you have to multiply the derivative y square, which is 2y times dy dx. So we have x square times 2y dy dx plus y squared times the derivative of x square, which is 2x. And now we will simplify this. Get x dy dx. ddx of x is 1, so we have plus y plus 1 plus dy dx equals 2x squared y dy dx plus 2xy squared. And now let's gather all the terms with dy dx in it. And we get x dy dx plus dy dx minus 2x squared y dy dx equals 2xy squared. And I'm going to bring these two terms to the other side. It'll be minus y minus 1. And factoring dy dx out, you get dy dx times x plus 1 minus 2x squared y equals 2xy squared minus y minus 1. And then finally solving for dy dx, we get 2xy squared minus y minus 1. And I'm going to write this term first in the denominator, minus 2x squared y plus x plus 1. And so you can see the answer is C. Now we have a function here that we want to find all the critical points for this function. Critical points are where the derivative is 0 or where the derivative is undefined. Okay. So writing f of x equals x squared minus 4x to the 1/2, we get the derivative is equal to 2x minus 2x to the minus 1/2, which is equal to 2x minus 2 over x to the 1/2. And we want to set this equal to 0 and solve for x. So combining these two fractions with different denominators, we get 2x to the 3/2 minus 2 over x to the 1/2. And setting that equal to 0, the only way this can be 0 is for the numerator to equal 0, so 2x to the 3/2 is going to be equal to 2. So x to the 3/2 equal 1. And the solution to that is x equal 1 to the 2/3 power, which is equal to 1. So the critical point of this function is x equal 1. Also, the derivative is not defined at x equals 0. Number 7, to calculate the limit of this expression using L'Hopital's rule. And if we first check to see if we can use L'Hopital's rule, we'll plug in 0 into the numerator and the denominator, and we get 0 over cosine 0 plus, minus 1 equals 0 over 1 minus 1 equals 0 over 0. So the requirement for L'Hopital's rule is that you get 0 over 0 for this. And L'Hopital's rule now says we can take the derivative of the numerator and the derivative of the denominator. So we write down limit as x approaches 0 of x squared over cosine of x minus 1 equals the limit as x approaches 0 of 2x over derivative of cosine of x is minus sine of x. And of course, the derivative of minus 1 is 0. Notice that this goes to 0 over 0. So we have to apply L'Hopital's rule another time. In fact, you could do this any number of times, depending on the problem. In this case, we'll see that this is equal to the limit as x approaches 0, taking the derivative again. We get 2 derivative minus sine of x is minus cosine of x. And this now is 2 over minus 1 equals minus 2. So the limit is minus 2. So we only had to do this twice. Here we have want to evaluate the integral given here. And here is where we need to use substitution. And what you generally want to do is pick a u whose derivative is there in the integrand, or either the derivative is some constant times a function in the integrand. So let's pick 7x squared plus 3. Notice that du dx is equal to 14x. So notice that we see x there, not 14x, but that's going to suffice. We can now say that dy dx equal 14x dx. And x dx then is equal to du over 14. So plugging all this in, we get the integral of x dx over 7x squared plus 3 to the fifth power is equal to the integral x dx is going to be du over 14 and 7x squared plus 3 is u, so we'll get u to the fifth. So u, which is 7x squared plus 3. Now we got a much simpler function to take the antiderivative of. And so we want to take 1 14th u to the minus 5. Notice we're going to take the antiderivative. And we need to bring the u to the fifth up to the numerator. And now, using the power antiderivative rule, we get 1 14th u to the minus 4 over minus 4 plus a constant equals minus 1 over 56. u, which is 7x squared plus 3 to the minus 4 plus a constant. And that is answer C. Notice you could have brought this down to the denominator and made it 7x squared plus 3 to the 4th power. Number 9 is another problem in which we need to evaluate the integral and come up with a substitution. This particular case, we see that if we pick u equals 6 plus 4x cubed, that du dx is equal to 12 x squared. That's not exactly the derivative, but it's just a factor of x squared dx. We see 7x squared dx. So du is equal to 12x squared dx, and x squared dx is equal to du over 12. So we're going to take this part of the integrand, and that's going to be du over 12. So the integral of 7x squared times the fourth root of 6 plus 4x cubed dx is going to be equal to x squared dx is du over 12, so we're going to get, and we'll leave the 7 there, 7 over 12 times fourth root of u. Notice that u is equal to 6 plus 4x squared du. So we will rewrite this as 7 twelfths u to the 1/4 power du. And this equals 7 twelfths u to the 5/4 divided by 5/4. And notice that 12 times 5/4 is 15. We have to add a constant here. So this equals 7 over 15. Replace u with 6 plus 4x cubed to the 5/4 plus a constant, and the answer is C. Number 10, we want to calculate the area between these two curves. And we want to identify the upper curve, which is y equal minus x to the 4th, and the lower curve, which is identified as y equal x to the 4th minus 32. So we want to integrate the top minus the bottom over the interval minus 2 to plus 2. So the area is going to be equal to integral from minus 2 to plus 2 of minus x to the 4th minus x to the 4th plus 32. Dx. And so we're going to end up integrating minus 2 to plus 2. Of minus 2x to the 4th. Plus 32. Dx. And this is going to be minus 2x to the 5th. Over 5 plus 32x between minus 2 and plus 2. So this equals minus 64 fifths, plugging 2 in here. Minus 64 fifths, plug in 2 here, plus 64, minus what you get when you plug minus 2 in. When you plug minus 2 in here, you get 64 fifths, and minus 2 here, you get minus 64. So we get 64 plus 64, which is 128, minus 128 fifths is equal to 512 fifths, which is the area between the two curves, which is answer C. Okay, we've got a problem here in which we're going to talk about whether a limit of f of x as x approaches 1 exists. And here is what we're given. We're given that f of 1 equals 5. So we would put a dot there. All we know is that there is one dot in this function. And we don't know anything else about the function. And the question is, does the limit of f of x as x approaches 1 exist? Notice that this function could look like almost anything outside of function of 1. So this function, we don't know if the limit exists. The function could look like this. In fact, it could do all sorts of things. And as x approaches 1, we don't know whether the limit from the left or the right are going to equal one another, and we don't even know if it could be 5. So the answer is no, because even if a function is defined at a point, the limit may not exist at that point, because you know you can think of all kinds of scenarios in which the limit was, this is a nice smooth function, or the function could be piecewise coming into one from the left and the right, and the function, the limit may not exist. Now, the other question is if the limit of f of x as x approaches 1, must it equal 5? Well, the answer is no. Because f of x could be a piecewise function where the limit approaching 1 from the left and right are the same, but f of 1 is defined as a different value. The kind of situation you could have here. F of 1 is equal to 5, but the function could look like that, which the limit was maybe 1 or 2. Last question, what can we conclude about the limit? We can conclude, we cannot conclude anything about this function given the information. If you're only given one point, you have no idea what's happening at all the other points, unless the function is further defined. Number 12, find the limit if it exists of this rational function. Notice, let's go ahead and plug in 4. If we plug in 4, we get 16 minus 36 plus 20 divided by 16 minus 24 plus 8 equals 0 over 0. So, looks like L'Hopital's rule might be a good tool to use here. So let's take the limit as x approaches 4 of x squared minus 9x plus 20 divided by x squared minus 6x plus 8. According to L'Hopital's rule, we can take the derivative of the numerator and denominator and see if that limit exists. The derivative is 2x minus 9 over 2x minus 6. And now plugging in 4, we get minus 1 over 2 equal minus 1/2. So the limit is minus 1/2. Here we have a function of powers of x divided by powers of x. And in this particular case, we want to take the term that dominates in the numerator, which is minus 4x to the minus 1 power. That's the highest power in the numerator. In the denominator, the highest power is minus 2x to the minus 2. This equals x as x approaches infinity equals infinity, because as x goes to infinity, 2x goes to infinity. So the answer is infinity. Now we want to find the derivative of this function. When you have x to a root, or x to the fourth to the fifth root, you need to rewrite all of this as x to the 4/5 power. And this is x to the power 4e. Now e is just a constant. So dy dx is equal to 4/5. X to the 4/5 minus 1, which is x to the minus 1/5. Plus 4e, x to the 4e minus 1. And notice that is answer C. Now, we're asked to sketch the graph of the function to determine whether it has any absolute extreme values or its domain on its domain. Notice that the function is 9 cosine of x, and the domain is 0 to 2 pi, not including the endpoints. So if you're familiar with your functions, notice the cosine starts out at its peak and then goes down, and we're going to plot it. And the end points are going to be holds because the function is not the function is not defined at 0 and 2 pi. So looking at the various functions here, this looks like cosine, this looks like cosine, and so does this. But the only one of these three that has holes at 0 and 2 pi is this one. Notice that it has an absolute min. And if the function was defined 0 and 2 pi, it would have an absolute max of 10. But notice there's a hole there. And as you get closer and closer to 2 pi, you get closer and closer to 10, but it never reaches the absolute max. So the answer to this, there's no absolute max, but there's an absolute minimum at x equal pi, which is right there in the middle of the graph. Now, what you can do is graph this from minus 10 to plus 10, just to check yourself. So we'll put 9 cosine of x, and look at the mode, make sure we're in the radian mode. Then I'm going to go from 0 to, we're going to go from minus 10 to plus 10. And we can also let y min be minus 10 and y max be plus 10. Notice the amplitude of this is going to be 9, so we got plenty of room. So if we graph it between minus 10 and plus 10, and notice that we're only interested in 0 to 2 pi, which is right here. So this is exactly the function that we have here, and that confirms that we got the right answer. Number 16, we want to find the absolute extrema values of the function here. Notice that f prime at x is equal to 8/3 x to the 5/3. And we set that equal to 0 to find the critical points. And it equals 0 at x equals 0. So x equals 0 is a critical point. We need to calculate the value of the function at that critical point, which is 0. And then we need to check the endpoints. So f at minus 1 is equal to minus 1 to the x to the 8/3 power. That's the cube root of minus 1, which is minus 1 times, with minus 1, then minus 1 to the 8th, it's going to be 1. And then we look at f at 8, the other endpoint, is equal to 8 to the 8/3 power equals 256. So now we look at all of these values. This is a min, this is max, so the answer is D, absolute max occurs at x equals 8, and it's 512. The absolute minimum is 0 at x equals 0. Number 17, we have a driver car traveling 60 miles an hour applies the brakes, and the position of the car is given by 60t minus 3t squared, t seconds after he brakes. How far does the car go before it comes to a stop? Well, the position is equal to 60t. Minus 3t squared. Now it comes to a stop. It stops when the velocity equals 0. Well, the velocity is equal to the first derivative of s, which is 60 minus 6t equals 0. So that occurs at t equal to 10. It stops at t equal to 10. How far has it gone? We plug s, but into s we plug 10. So s at 10 is equal to 60 times 10 minus 3 times 10 squared. Equals 600 minus 300 equals 300. So at 300 feet is how long it takes to come to a stop. Next problem. Rock is thrown vertically, and its position is given by s equal 120t minus 3t squared. How high does the rock go? How long does it take the rock to reach its highest point? Well, s is equal to 120t minus 3t squared. The rock is going to go up until V equals 0, until it's actually slows down to velocity of 0, and then it's going to start coming back down. So at the highest point, V equals 0. So the velocity is equal to S prime equal 120 minus 6T equals 0. At t equal 20. So its position at its highest point is going to be s at 20 equal 120 times 20 minus 3 times 20 squared, which is 400. And this is equal to 1,200 meters. And so the answer is B. Its maximum height is 1,200 meters, and it reaches that in 20 seconds. Now, we want to find the tangent line, the equation of the tangent line to the function y equal cotangent of x at x equal pi over 4. First of all, y at pi over 4 is equal to cotangent of pi over 4, which equals 1. So the tangent line has got to go through the point pi over 4 and 1. And to calculate the slope of the tangent line, we need to take dy dx is equal to minus cosine squared of x equals minus 1 over sine squared of x. And dy dx at the point x equals pi over 4 is equal to minus 1 over sine of pi over 4 squared equals minus 1 over the square root of 2 over 2 squared, which is minus 1 divided by 2 fourths. And this equals minus 2. So the slope of the tangent line is minus 2. So we can write that the equation of the tangent line is y equals mx plus b, and y equals m, which is minus 2, x plus b. And we need to plug in x equal pi over 4 and y equal 1. So we get 1 equals minus 2 pi over 4 plus b. So B equals 1 plus 2 pi over 4, which is pi over 2. So we can now write that the equation is y equals minus 2x plus B, which is pi over 2 plus 1, or 1 plus pi over 2. And that is answer D. Number 20 is an optimization problem in which we have manufacturing so many units and selling them and getting a revenue as a function of the number of units and the cost of producing a number of units. And we want to maximize the profit. So the profit function is equal to the revenue that you get minus the cost of that product. So So the profit is equal to the revenue, which is 40x minus 0.5x squared minus cost, which is 9x plus 9. Just need to be careful here. This is a simple problem. This is 40x minus 9x is 31x minus 0.5x squared minus 9. So we take the derivative of the profit. We want to set that equal to 0. And we get 31 minus x equals 0. So x equals 31 is the number of units to produce to give the highest profit. So this is answer D. Now we have a function here. Gives the position of a body moving on a coordinate line. We want to find the body's acceleration at t equals pi over 3. The velocity is equal to s prime, which is equal to minus 7 sine of t. That's the first derivative of s. So the acceleration is equal to the derivative of the velocity, which is the second derivative of position. And this is going to be equal to minus 7 cosine of t. So the acceleration at pi over 3 is minus 7 cosine of pi over 3. Cosine of pi over 3 is a half. So this is minus 7 halves. So the answer is minus 7 halves meters per second squared acceleration. Problem 22, find the second derivative of this function. You always will need to rewrite this and put the x to the power in the numerator. Do not flip the 11, though. Leave that there, so it's 1/11 x to the minus 2 plus 1/9 x to the minus 1. So since this is y, the first derivative is equal to minus 2 over 11 x to the minus 3 minus 1/9 x to the minus 2. To get the second derivative, we take the derivative again, and you get 6/11 x to the minus 4 plus 2/9 x to the minus 3. And now it seems like they want us to rewrite this, bring the x to the minus 4 down to the denominator and the x to the minus 3 down here. So this is the second derivative. And looks like the answer is A. Now, number 23, we've got a function given here, and we want to figure out which of the graphs below happens to be its derivative. But what I want to do is blow this up a little bit. In fact, I'm going to actually draw it a little bigger. If we look in the very middle there, we're going to see something like this. And the derivative at this point is zero. The derivative at this point is zero. And the derivative in the middle is negative. So we know the derivative between this point and this point is going to look like this. Notice the derivative is positive here. The derivative is positive here. So this function is going to look like, the derivative function is going to look like this. And the answer I see here is B. None of the others look like that. I want to find the integral here of this function. It looks sort of messy. But a key thing is to look for a substitution whose derivative you see right there in front of you, or either a factor of the derivative, constant factor. So if we let u equal inverse sine of x, du dx is equal to 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. So du is equal to 1, is equal to dx over the square root of 1 minus x squared. So this part becomes du. U is inverse sine of x. So the integral becomes e to the u du, which is greatly simplified. So the integral of e to the u du is just simply e to the u plus a constant, which is e to the inverse sine of x plus a constant. And that's the answer that goes here. E to the inverse sine of x plus a constant. Number 25 is a related rates problem. We have a spherical balloon. It's being inflated at the rate of 4860 pi cubic centimeters per minute. At what rate is the radius changing when the radius is 9 centimeters? So we're given that dv dt is equal to 4860 pi. And we want to find dr dt. When r is 9 centimeters. So let's write down the volume is equal to 4/3 pi r cubed. So to calculate dv dt, we take dv dt is equal to ddt of 4/3 pi r cubed. Now notice we don't see a t here. We see an r, but we know that r is a function of t. So we take the derivative with respect to r first, which is 4 pi r squared, and multiply times dr dt. So now we have dv dt is equal to 4 pi r squared dr dt. dv dt is 4860 pi. Equals 4 pi r squared, which is 81. R is 9 times dr dt. So we can solve for dr dt equal 48, 60 pi divided by 4 pi times 81. And you'll find that this is equal to 15. So the answer is C, 15. Okay, problem 26, the last one, is one in which we have to use the quotient rule. The derivative g prime of x is going to be the denominator, x squared plus 6x, times the derivative of the numerator, which is 2x, minus the numerator times the derivative of the denominator, which is 2x, plus 6, divided by the denominator squared, which is x squared plus 6x, quantity squared. And we need to simplify the numerator, which gives us 2x cubed plus 12x squared minus, we have to multiply these two, which will give us 2x cubed plus 6x squared plus 10x plus 30. And I'm going to go ahead and write this denominator as x times x plus 6 quantity squared. Which would be x squared times x plus 6 squared. And now further simplification, we get 2x cubed minus 2x cubed gives us no x cubes, 12x squared minus 6x squared gives us 6x squared. And then we have minus 10x and minus 30 divided by x squared times x plus 6 quantity squared.